It is my great pleasure to welcome on the show this afternoon the one and only Chris Chameleon. Chris, baie welkom.
Thanks, Martin. Lekker om hier te wees.
Ek vir jou al lank al ontmoet het. I'm a fan of your stuff. Ek was vroeger vandag by die haarkapper gewees. And then I quote her, sy sê, vir so dynamiese ou moet hy seker een klein bietjie mal in sy kop wees.
Ja, nee, dis waar. En hy sny ook nie sy haar gereeld nie, so sy ken hom 10-10-1 ook nie regtig nie.
Dude, baie geluk met as jy weer skryf.
Ja, baie dankie.
Hy doen baie, baie goed in die Afrikaanse muziekwereld. Voor ons meer oor hom praat, ek het die vraag about Boo and Chris Chameleon as Chris Chameleon.
Uh-huh.
You obviously look different.
Yeah,
but sure. Do you feel different?
Yes, I do, absolutely. I mean, that's where the chameleon comes from. I slip into a different personality and I become that for a while. And I really need that. I mean, Boo had a 6-year hiatus and that was more than my system could bear. And ek het die AP in my kassie gehad dat ek moes uitlaat. And daarom is ons terug. It's crazy, it's far out, and it's not the thing I usually do with my Afrikaans shows, you know, where I sit down and I'm really neat, because I am really neat, actually, but I'm also not really neat, and there's a time and a place for everything, and I'm really glad for that outlet.
Was jy nie redig geweest vir die Boo split?
You know, the thing about the Boo split was, ons het so baie getoer, nee, ons het 800 optredes in 17 lande in 7 jaar.
800?
Ja, bo, dis groot. En allemaal is nie uitgeknip vir hy lewe op die pad nie. So dit was 'n verskriklike strawwe lewe en dit was nie altyd so glansryk nie. It wasn't very glamorous.
Dis harde werk.
Ja, dit is harde werk en is baie opoffering. Jy weet, jy gee byvoorbeeld, you forfeit any chance at a normal life. And at some stage you're like, it would be nice to have a dog.
And know its name.
Yes, know its name and it recognizes you. And you know, there's that
and a lawnmower, yeah, right. Your eerste solo Afrikaanse album was dit a clean cut. Kijk er al, yo. That's obviously got to do with a monkey. I mean, you weet, was it a cleansing process om to be the cleanse van Boo en om 'n neater Chris Chameleon voor te stel?
Gelukkig nie. Toe Boo tot op die einde gekom het, ons laaste vertoning was op die 14e December 2004.
Hmm.
En in die begin 2005 het ek geweet wat om te doen nie. En toe bel Sione aan my en hulle vraag my om 'n dichter, enige dichter te toonset. Een liedjie daarvan vir een van hulle programme.
Okay.
Ek het toe 2 getoonset, hulle het van al 2 gehou en ek het dit gaan speel op Sione Laan. En daai dag kom maar toe 'n joernalis en sê, maar gaan jy 'n plaat maak? En ek jok toe, ek sê toe, ja. En die volgende dag is in die koerante, toe het ek nie 'n keuse nie. Ek moet nie iets sê en het word, ja, dis hoe dit gebeur het. Toe gaan sit ek en ek het binne 2 weke die hele album getoons het. Maar die geluk van Ek Herhaal Jou was, dit was Ingrid Jonker se woorde. So ek moes my laat lei deur haar woorde. Ek voel ook baie van die melodie waarmee ek opgekom het, was eintlik opgesluit in die woorde gewees.
Mm.
Asof ek nie krediet daarvoor kan neem nie.
Mm.
So dit was nie 'n doelbewuste verskuiwing in persoonlikheid en so nie. My persoonlikheid is bepaal deur my die werk waarmee ek besig was. At the end of the day, it was the stuff that the given, which was Ingrid Jonker's work. And if you're going to do it that way, because I also come from an acting background, I assimilate personalities. That's why I call myself Chris Chameleon, because I come into an environment and I assimilate it and I represent it again for what it is. That change in my personality and my persona was actually dictated by the work itself. I still feel I'm really inspired by her work en sy is regtig, jy weet, 'n fenomenale digter gewees. En ek het eintlik maar net so gespeel met hier en daar 'n gediggie net om so 'n bietjie in die ding te kom van die skepingsgees terwyl ek op my plaat was en die volgende oomblik toe gryp daai ding my by die kraag en sê do me and do me now.
Right now.
Yeah, and that's how it happened.
That is amazing. I like the fact that, I mean, how much thought went into the whole process of calling yourself Chris Chameleon? Because one of the things about the industry is to try and box you as neatly as they possibly can,
yeah,
and to put you into a genre and all these other terms and crazy, crazy boundaries. And here comes a guy along, calls himself Chris Chameleon, and he says, you know what, if I want to go up in a dress, then sure. If I want to sing Afrikaans, then sure. As ek Engels wil sing, dan, you know, dan sal ek. I mean, as jy nou terugdink, was daar daai type van gedagtes gewees?
Nee, nie regtig nie. Ek was nog altyd, jy weet, intens bewus gewees van die chameleonisme in ons almal. Jy weet die feit dat jy nie dieselfde ou is voor jou meisie as wat jy voor jou baas is, wat jy voor jou ma is, wat jy voor jou pelle is. Nee, en dit is nie dat jy skynheilig is nie, dis maar net 'n verskillende kant van die aspek van die persoonlikheid wat jy toon na gelang van die omstandighede. En ek is nog altyd baie bewus daarvan dat ander mense dit doen, dat ek dit doen en dat dit natuurlik is. En ek het ook agtergekom dat in die uitvoering van meeste kunstenaars se werk beperk hulle self eintlik. Dis nou nie 'n baie kritiese blik op my mede-kunstenaars nie, maar ek bedoel net, die hele lewe is nie pap nie. Die hele lewe is nie jazz nie. Die hele lewe is nie rock of hard rock.
You get bored, surely.
Yeah, you know, and you are more diverse than that. So why as an artist, especially when art should be life represented, you know, re-represented, why should it be more limited than the person who's actually doing it?
Exactly. Imagine if you had to do a workshop type thing where you go up to certain artists and you say to them, I dub the, you know, whoever, Chameleon, Steve Chameleon.
Yeah, far out. Or go to Kurt Darren and say, do heavy metal today, you know.
I dub the Kurt Chameleon. Yes, and you give him the, you know, the freedom of Chameleon and see, you know, where it takes him. And he'll probably thank you because you're probably thankful that you called yourself Chris Chameleon in the first place.
Yeah, that'll be far out. Or you go to Prime Circle and you say, okay, guys, now do a piece of Afrikaner, a Volksspieler, or whatever it is.
Yeah.
It's a good thing to think out of the box and put yourself out there. But then again, you know, we're also in a business. And for a lot of artists, it's actually a danger to step outside that zone. That's what your fans are used to. And if you break away from that, you might scare people. Ja, definitief. Ek meen, na 22 jaar het ek al 'n goeie idee van hoe dit werk. Mm. En een ding wat ek kan sê is, niemand kan dit regtig bepaal nie. Daar kom baie keer mense en sê, hoorie man, wat kan ek doen om ook 'n ster te wees? En sê, ek weet nie, ek kan myself skaars help. Jy weet, ek kan vir jou sekere goeie sê, maar aan die einde van die dag is er die regte plek, die regte tyd. Ek dink nog steeds die grootste bepalende faktor in hierdie bedryf is geluk. Maar nood vir brood gaan om, ek gebruik my eie loopbaan as 'n voorbeeld, sodat ek nou die musiek uit my afgelope 22 jaar kan gebruik. En ek gebruik dit om vir mense te wys die stappe waardeur ek gaan het, die foute wat ek gemaak het, en is eintlik baie komies. Jy weet, die hele aanslag wat ek daarop sit, the entire spin is one of comic relief, and to let people see, ach, you know what, we're all just people.
How honest are you in the show?
Super honest.
Really?
Super honest, yeah. But, well, everything I say is 100% truth, but I don't say 100% the truth. You know what I'm saying? Because people don't have to know what goes on in the bathroom or whatever, you know? But when you're in the kitchen, and you can just say everything that's true about the kitchen, but that's not the whole house. So it's more like that. That's actually the approach I generally take in my career. Ek hou daarvan om altyd 100% eerlik te wees. Ek dink dit resoneer met mense. Mense dink, "Ah, nee, maar die ou is hy's vreemd, maar hy's eg."
Ja, hy's eg.
En dan aan die einde, wat lekker is van die vertoning is aan die einde van die vertoning vat ons al hierdie inligting, al hierdie ervaring wat ons opgedoen het en ons skep die nuwe hit. En ek sê jou, dit is 'n treffer na die tyd kom die mense en sê, "Hoorie, ek soek daai liedjie," en dan is dit vir myself moeilik om vir hulle te sê, nee, maar dis eintlik 'n grapie.
Nee, maar ek soek daai liedjie, daai is 'n hit, man, daai is die volgende groot hit.
Well, you're going to have to maybe just release it.
Perhaps I should. You know?
Maybe you should leave I mean, you're talking about the kitchen stuff. Maybe you should leave the bathroom bits for a book. That's what people seem to do.
No, you're right, actually.
I'm
working on it.
Oh, really?
Yes, but I'll only be ready for it when I can really afford the punch, that, you know, the backlash. Because that's a story I want to tell, and I think there's a lot to be learned from it. And it's, yeah, you know, us artists, we're weird. You know, we got to do something to feel like we have a purpose, a sense of being.
Your English stuff, if I dare say, was slightly more adventurous than the Afrikaans stuff.
Indeed.
But not quite boo either.
Yeah, totally. I think it is because, and I hope I don't get into trouble for saying this, but the English world is very, has been tried and tested. It's been around for so long. And in English, you have punk music, and you have this music, and you have that music. You have the heaviest stuff, you have the lightest stuff, you have the most naff stuff, you have everything. Whereas in Afrikaans, because it's a fairly new language, it's a fairly new industry, it's still, unfortunately, I think, limited in its diversity of expression. And Afrikaners are, you know, for all their bravery and the fact that we really know how to gooi a rugby ball and druk a drie and all those wonderful things in jag and so, actually, ons hartjies is klein, jy weet.
Mm.
En Afrikaners, as jy hulle te hard gooi met 'n ding, dan is dit nou nie so lekker vir hulle, jy weet.
But then someone comes along, and that happened, the same happened in the English music industry, if you think about it. If you had to go back to the you know, 30s and 40s, and then Elvis Presley comes along, and he pushes the boundaries a bit, and awakens that something inside of people, they go, actually, I do like rock and roll. Yeah. And this is what jy gedoen het, dink ek, met Afrikaanse musiek. Op 'n stadium waar baie commercial was, en baie pop was, cool, it worked, it sold. Maar kom iemand, wat so klein bietjie met braaf is, slightly a bit more Chameleon, and just stretch it a little bit, and then people realize, I kind of like that as well.
Dit is waar.
So keep doing that.
Dit is waar, en ek meen, dit is waar ons in die afgelope 10 jaar goed gesien het, soos die polisiekarre, jy weet, hoe hulle daar gekom het, en mense sou dink, nee, dit kan nie werk nie.
It will never work.
Ja, en tot almal se verbasing het die ouens goud gegaan, en is 'n ongelooflike ding wat hulle daar gedoen het. Mens kan dit doen, maar, jy weet, ek leef dit toch uit in my Engelse muziek, ek leef dit hieruit, en ek leef dit daaruit, maar weet jy wat is die ander ding? my persoonlikheid is ook 'n bietjie gekoppel aan my taal. Ek is vlot in 4 tale en ek moet vir jou sê, elke keer as ek daai taal praat, word ek 'n ander mens. Ek kan dit nie help nie. Ek voel net eenvoudig soos 'n ander mens. Wanneer ek myself in Afrikaans uitdruk, dan kom maar hierdie een ou uit, jy weet. Dis die ou wat my ma groot gemaak het. As ek Engels praat, dan kom maar hierdie ander ou uit. Dis die ou wat my pelle groot gemaak het. As ek Duits praat, dan kom maar hierdie ou uit. Hy's 'n tegniese ou, hy's 'n nadenkende ou. As ek Hollands praat, dan kom maar hierdie groot bek liberalis uit. En ek, jy weet, ek gaan nie pa staan vir al hierdie karakters nie. Ek laat hulle nou maar hulle gang gaan, maar ek voel dat die taal wat ek praat definitief dit dikteer tot 'n groot mate die wyse waarop my persoonlikheid uitkom.
Dis interessant en in haar perspektief nie, want ek praat maar net 2 tale, wat ek 2.5.
Voel jy nie 'n verskil tussen Afrikaans en Engels?
Natuurlik.
Praat nie of nie. Dit is so klein, dit is tog so 'n bietjie anders, hè?
Natuurlik. Ek dink as ek moes in Afrikaans opneem, sou ek miskien anders daar gevoel het. Absolutely. Het jy al ooit opgeneem in Duits?
Nee, nog nie. Ja, gelukkig.
Can you imagine the stuff that comes out there? Is it going to be hard?
Ja, ek het 'n gedig van Goethe, een van sy bekendste gedigte. Goethe is my gunsteling Duitse skrywer en ek het een van sy gedigte getoon set. Maar is so 'n punk weergawe van Roseline of the Heide. en ek doen dit in my lewendige vertonings. Ek doen ook iets in, jy weet, 'n Nederlandse digter wat ek getoon set het. So ek doen daai goeters en daar kom 'n ander ding daar uit. Duits is nogal lekker vir punk hoor.
For some reason, I don't know why I kind of went from German to slightly harder kind of, maybe even on the metally side and the punky side. It's just, probably they were here recently. Wildest gig ever. Wildest gig ever. I mean, you played Pukkelpop, Fierce in Belgium and 16 other lande.
I've played some pretty wild gigs, you know, especially in Eastern Europe, in Hungary, the Czech Republic, Croatia, Slovenia. We played gigs and it's just wild and rough and onbeskof and it's net hierdie mense wat daar uitkruip wat jy dink, okay, now I'm very deep in the Eastern Europe. But you know, and then there those Italian gigs where it's just like, yep, 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 and it's like, and you just go crazy. But I think the wildest gig, for a variety of reasons, was the time we supported, here at St. Julian, we supported Smashing Pumpkins. Because the night before, I just got bored with myself. And it might have been subconscious, but I know that consciously I didn't think of Billy Corgan's appearance when I did that. But I actually shaved off all my hair. And ek was kaal kop geweest. And I don't know if you've ever shaved off your hair, but it's the weirdest feeling. It's like that when you put your finger next to someone else's finger and you feel it. And
yes.
It's like a dead man's finger, that little trick for the children. That's what your head feels like. And I couldn't sleep all night. You know, tomorrow I have this big gig, a really important gig, and I slept something like 40 minutes. I got to the show, to Centurion, and my own band didn't recognize me. I walked, they were sitting there, and I was like, hi, guys. And they're like, ah, you know, sort of ignoring, that must be a fan. I was like, hey, it's me. They're like, ah, what did you do to yourself, you know? And I also changed my clothes. I just went on with like an army pants and topless and stuff. And it was actually one of the most kick-ass gigs we ever had. Johan Griesel did the sound, and people said we never sounded that good. And Billy Corgan was standing in the wings, and he was like, by the time we went off, he quickly disappeared. But I subsequently heard that he was also pretty impressed. But it was a wild gig. Everything about it was just wild and really wonderful. But not the sex, drugs, rock and roll kind of vibe, which we also had in Eastern Europe. But yeah, all in all, I would say that's the gig.
Now listen, that's the book you release after the bathroom bits.
Indeed.
Sex, drugs and rock and roll in Eastern Europe.
We'll stay in the kitchen for now.
Stay in the kitchen for now. Vanaand, ek hoop jy het 'n wild gig, 'n awesome gig, in die bos op die MK verhoog.
Dis reg, ja.
En naspreid by in die bos.
So dis 'n wonderlike ding van in die bos, dat ek al twee hierdie kante van my kan uitleef. En ek dink is 'n fantastiese fees, so mens mag het nie sê nie, maar ek dink is dalk my gunsteling fees in die land. Hulle doen goeders reg daar, jy weet, hulle... dis 'n verskriklike groot plesier om by daai fees op te tree hoor, as 'n kunstenaar.
It's one of the very few festivals that could cater for you, that could have Boo on one stage,
yes,
and Chris Chameleon doing something else on another.
That's
think
totally
about it.
True, and it should be surprising because you think, yeah, you know, stuck out there in Mpumalanga and Nelspruit in the boeregemeenskap and so, but you get there and the people are like, yay, you know.
I love that. I love that about that festival.
Yeah,
it's amazing.
It's wonderful. No, I mean, I really have a very soft spot for Nelspruit because, you know, the last 2 years I received the award for the most supported show, for the most popular show.
That's
at
right.
The festival. And it's something I would never have thought of in my wildest dreams 10 years ago. But I think it's also a bit of a self-indictment because what it really indicates is that I'm underestimating ons eie mense. Ek moet bietjie regkom, maar dink jy?
Weet jy, if someone else was sitting opposite me, I may have said yes, but I think you're doing just fine. Let no one ever hold you back.
Thank you.
May the chameleon take you exactly where you want to go because we're loving it. We're absolutely loving it. Jou nuwe video, Elke,
gaan binnenkort op MK vrygestel word, exclusief.
Ja, ja, en is gek hoor. Dit is eintlik 'n vier reeltjie gedig van Ingrid Jonker. Elke man het 'n kop, 'n lyf en twee bene. Hulle probeer jou namaak. En is in elk geval weer 'n man dit sê, weet, want wat probeer die ou nou eintlik sê? Dis 'n gedig vir 'n vrou. En dis 'n dilemma wat ek dikwels kry met Ingrid Jonker se werk. Maar vir hierdie video het ek gedink om die Frankensteinian tipe inspirasie te gebruik. En ek maak myself, maar ek is 'n opperse... Dit is wel lekker ou nie, hoe sal mens dit sê?
Een knol.
Knol. Kan ek daarvan, ja.
Booswig.
Ja, booswig, ja. En dan maak ek myself en dan my assistent, wat 'n baie mooie meisie is. Sy probeer my aandag kry, geen nie van aandag nie. En dan maak ek myself en dan maak ons my dood en loop weg met
my. So, klein bietjie whack. Misschien is een bietjie boe geïnspireerd.
Ja, dit is baie gek, dit is baie soos die boe ding, maar dit is maar die ding wat ons vroeger gesê het, jy weet, die mense baie keer in Afrikaans moet dit ook so 'n bietjie stoot, en die eerste video van die album, as jy weer skryf, was konseptueel baie sterk video, want ek het die hele video teen twee keer die spoed agterste voor
gedoen. Oh, wow.
So ek het die lied opgeneem, teen die normale spoed, en het toe teen twee keer die spoed agterste voor gespeel, en dit geleer sing. So as jy hom gewoonlik speel, is dit, as jy weer in jou dagboek skryf, onthou om die gouden blaar te sien in die som, dan gaan hy so, maar as jy het agterste voor, dan is dit, schrinnel of traf stem, ke, deep dit laf, onnet kut, af en ons het nie, so toe, jemal. So, en moes die hele ding geleer, het my baie lang gevat, en dan loop ek achteruit by die see in, loop in die see in, stap uit die see uit, dan lyk het, as jy nou alles normaal speel, dat ek beweeg in starige aksie, maar ek sing normale spoed, en ek begin nat, dan gaan ek in die see in, en dan kom ek droog, en reis ek uit die water uit, natuurlijk die parallelle met Ingrid Jonker se lewe. So dit was 'n mooi video, het is konseptueel sterk geweest, en toe wou ek met elke man het die kop ook bietjie aan die ander kant doen, 'n baie wilde ding, en dis waar het vandaan kom.
Awesome, do come back, please, it was great having you on the show this afternoon, thanks so much for coming in, bye bye, dankie.
Ja, dankie Martin, lekker gewees. Vir altyd bedenk, vir altyd bedenk.